What a meeting we've had this morning already. I love the fact that we can just be family and we don't have to do things the same way. And it's in order. This is in order. I know I had somebody one time tell me, he's like, oh, I can't go to a church that a pastor would hand the microphone to people that you don't know what they're going to say. I handed the microphone to somebody this morning I've never met before. I guess Chris. And I'm like, yeah, that is kind of scary in the natural, isn't it? But when you're family, we need to hear from each other. We need to hear from each other. We need to know each other. In this setting, it's really more of a school. I mean, coming together, they came together and they taught. Okay, this is like teaching, you know. But reality is, real church is what we do on Monday nights in our home and what we do in your homes and what we do when you get together at the restaurant and sit around the table and we talk and we become family. We are interacting. That's really what church is. That's how the church grew in the New Testament. It said they gathered, they went house to house, breaking bread, praying, breaking bread. They were breaking spiritual bread, but they were actually eating together and sharing together, getting to know each other. And they were under great persecution. And out of that great persecution is how the gospel was spread. I don't know what's going to happen with America, but I do know what the Word says. The Word says that for those that love God, all things work together for good. I don't know what it's going to take for us to usher in a revival in the end and for people to see the glory of God, but I know sometimes it takes catastrophe. I don't know what's going to happen. I have no idea, but I do know in who my God is, that He's a good, good Father, and I happen to be His child, and He loves me, and He's for me, but also know that He put me with a family, and that's what's so important, because we do get weary at times, and we do need each other to come along and give honor. And it's funny because I don't even know how this, I guess I'm just going to jump over here. Actually, there's a scripture that goes along with what you said, and I was only going to use the end of it, but I actually made the rest of it like really tiny because I thought, I don't know why I even left it here when I was doing it, I've been talking about peace, haven't I? We've been talking now for some weeks about peace. I thought it was going to be a quick, you know, one or two teaching on peace, and I would go on to the next part of the armor. And we just stopped here. I mean, really and truly, this is the seventh time we've been talking about it. The seventh time we've been talking about peace and the different levels of peace. And we've learned about the peace of God. We talked about peace with God. And then we've been talking about here last week, we talked about ways that when we leave our peace, or that we don't all of a sudden, like Sister Linda said, we don't choose to walk in our peace. And the Bible equates peace to the shoes. It's what that standing, that Brother Ken just talked about, standing and walking. The feet always was an indication of behavior and it's the foundation of what brings us into where we're going. Whether we're going to stand, we're going to fall down, we're going to walk the wrong way, the right way. Shoes was huge. And then he said, the way you're going to be able to protect this part of you, which is so important, that determines what kind of life you have here and beyond, is peace. Not being in conflict, but being in peace. Being at peace with God and not conflict with God. And then so we talked about why is it all of a sudden we don't have peace? So we found out if you ask your kids, where's your shoes? We got to go. It's time to go to Sunday school. And I gave all my shoes. Well, where'd you take them off at? Victoria, where'd you leave your shoes? They're in my closet. Well, if they's in your closet, they'd still be in your closet. Where'd you leave your shoes, sweetheart? That sound like your Nana right now. Work, but I kind of start and talk like her. It's like the culture. Because I love her. Oh, yeah. I was out there watching the chickens or scratching on the goats or something. I left them outside. Sometimes you got to say, wait a minute. Where is my peace at? Where did you leave it? We talked last week ways that we leave our peace. Where is it? God didn't take your peace from you. He said, my peace I give to you, and I'm not taking it back. The devil can't steal your peace. That's a lie. Oh, the devil took my peace. No, he didn't. You're giving him credit he don't have. Peace is is one of the fruit of the Spirit, and he ain't messing with that. It's the Spirit's fruit. It's one of the nine fruit we talked about. So we talked about one way we leave our places we leave our peace was when we go do our own thing. We don't even stop and consider God. We're not walking in intimacy with him. We get up and run outside and do it our way. And it's not that we're doing anything wrong. It's just we're not even acknowledging him. We're just doing it my way. But I promise you, if you do it long enough, the second thing you come to is you're not in peace because you're actually in willful disobedience. If you mess around long enough just in your flesh, before you know it, your flesh will get into something that you just can't say no to. And it just feels so right. If loving you is wrong, I don't want to be right. That's where we start the, but God. Feels so right. How could it be wrong? Oh, it might feel right to the flesh, but I'm going to tell you something. If you've got the Spirit of God in you, then what did he say? He said, you let the peace of God rule and make the dominion. Because that little peace gauge, bing, 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 bing. Somebody just like, bam, wake up. Sometimes I wish he'd have done that to me because I ignored that little ding, 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 ding. Because the peace of God that's in you will rule if you will just let it. He said you have to allow the peace. That means let the peace. That means you have a choice. You can just say, well, I don't care what that says. Justify what you do. Get on and just keep on walking in your way and see where it takes you. So that's the second thing we do. We walk in willful disobedience. And Isaiah, I love the scripture. He said, if you just hearkened to my commandments, then you would have peace as if it had been a river. Oh, why didn't you listen? Sister Linda talked about that frustration when you're trying to help people and they come to you for help. And you give them some good, godly, sound, biblical advice, and they just say, okay. And they take your whole time and your effort and your time away from your family, and then they just going to do what they're going to do anyway, right? Because a man convinced against his will is of the same opinion still. God did not give me the responsibility to make you change your mind. What he gave me is just to love you and teach the best I can. And the truth is, you are the one that has to listen to the Holy Spirit. You are not my sheep, you're his. He just said, you're under shepherds, but I am the great shepherd, and my sheep know my voice. You hear God when you, it's in there if you'll just stop. And I had a young man write me this morning, I read. He put on Facebook, and he wrote a long deal, and he tagged us. It's a young man who lives way up east, but used to be a part of our youth. And he was just talking about that turmoil. But at some point, even if it's been years, I haven't seen him. He's probably in his 40s now, and he's talked about being in his 20s when or a teenager at our house. But he's struggling right now with something inside him. He said, there's a scripture, because he's been totally away from God. I mean, even his mind questioned everything about God, very agnostic. And he said, there's a scripture came to my mind that said, be still and know I'm God. He said, there's something about when you get still. You just kind of know. Steal what? Steal the voices in your head. Steal your own thoughts, your own figuring stuff out. Be still. And then you're going to know I'm God. And I'll be with you. The third thing we studied, and I got really kind of hung up on last week, was no matter how you're walking, no matter what you're doing, if you go home and your house is out of order, kind of hard to have peace, isn't it? One way we leave our peace is when we walk out of order from God. That's those first two things, our way and sometimes just wrong way. We already know it's just willful disobedience, not just accidental because we make mistakes and all of us do. But no, it's when we will it, when we start saying, I don't care what God says, I'm going to do it my way. And that's a dangerous place. And some people are doing that in their own homes, men and women, husbands and wives and children. Because when you talk about the home, now you're talking about husbands and wives, unless you are a single parent. And that's what has complicated things, too. And when you're single parents, it was never meant to be that way, a woman raising kids by herself, a man raising kids by herself. That was never, what was it? That was not in the plan. But that's where we are today. And you know what? He doesn't abandon us, go, well, you didn't do it my way. Dumb kid, get out of here. No, he's like, I understand. In fact, he said something that was very powerful. He said, I will be a father to the fatherless. And he said, when your father and mother forsake you, I will take you up. He said, the church, the mother of us all, the New Jerusalem. So he comes in there and girds us up in every place. That's why he said he's perfect in all of his ways. That means complete. He knows what you need, so there is no excuse. Well, I just don't have a husband. I don't have a wife. I don't have kids. You're without excuse because he is complete. And he will complete you in every way. And he will come up and undergird you. Even when we do it wrong, even when we get it wrong, even when we have failed relationships because we were looking for love in all the wrong places, or sometimes we were trying to walk with him and the other person was looking for love in all the wrong places. Things happen to people, don't they? Life happens. Things happen. Where do we have our peace? Yes, we have to get things in order. But the fourth one I'm going to go into today, and I'm not going to have time to near do what I thought I was going to do, and that's just okay, because we were supposed to do what we've done today. Well, I had it right to start with. There we go. Number four is, am I in conflict with somebody else? I may have my home in order. I may have everything going good at home. But when I get to work, conflict. Conflict with a boss, conflict with a coworker, conflict with the system. Or I go to church and I have conflict. Oh, I'll just skip on over this one. Our family, we have conflict. Some people dread the holidays. Why? Because I'm going to be with family. And they got conflict. Oh, let's just go back to it. It ain't about just your natural family. It's also your spiritual family. Because the thing is we, a lot of us, we can't even help the junk that's in our families. It is out of order. I can't help it. I'm walking in that place. But you know what we want to do? Then we want to run to the church and say, but you're my real family. People say, my real family. No, this is the real family because I'm really a spirit. And this is my spiritual family. I just live in a body and have a natural family. You don't get to choose your natural family, do you? You didn't choose who your mama got pregnant with that had you. So you didn't get to choose your daddy. You didn't get to choose your mama. You don't get to choose your brothers and sisters. That's out of your control. It's not yours. That was mom and daddy's responsibility. But you know, it's the same way in the church. Do you know you don't get to pick your brothers and sisters? In your family, I guarantee that you got a favorite aunt and maybe a not so favorite aunt. You got favorite cousins, not so favorite. Some people you don't even like them at all. But they're family. And you let somebody die and you're all going to be there crying around the same casket, all me and my cousins. When we lost our grandmas. But even with that, you think that was without conflict? Very few funerals I've gone to that there hadn't been some conflict. Somebody's already upset about something. Because that's family. Same way with weddings. Same way with weddings. We experienced a wedding lately. Somebody go buy a car, attack the bride. I'm telling you what, we had a brawl. Big white dress. It's broke her heart. Just rent that gorgeous wedding. Somebody drive up in a car, they're offended, mad, going to get up and show everybody what they can say and do. No, but it happens. Much conflict in weddings and in funerals and things that we should, holidays, conflict. It's kind of hard to sing peace on earth, goodwill toward men. And Uncle So-and-so is back in the back room. Well, let me tell you. Okay, let's just get back. Y'all are interested in that. One of the bridesmaids walked past me in the middle of this and slapped me on the back and said, hey, preacher, did your Jesus prepare you for this? Sure enough. Sure enough. Now, I said, uh-huh. He did. Oh, yes, he did. I spent some time behind the bars. to handle with care and restraint techniques every year, passed it. Now, I just grinned. I mean, I was like, well, I thought I was prepared. Your Jesus prepare you for this? Yeah. Yes, he did, praise God. Yes, he did. Now, I'm not going to be spiritual. I ain't going to get to this, but it's going to be all right. Conflict. We're singing, peace on earth, goodwill toward men, as you're fighting and who got what and your kids didn't get this and they're mad because, let's be real about it. We all live with some conflict, do we not? Now, you show me a perfect family and I'll show you a good liar, because there is no such thing. And not only is there no such thing in your natural family, but there's no such thing in your spiritual family. There's some of you, you're going to like each other more than others. Some of you don't even know each other. I mean, I've got some foreign cousins. I've got some cousins way down the line. My kids be warm and I go, that's your cousin. They go, Mama, how many cousins we got? Well, when you're kin to the Joneses and what, I mean, you have 9 kids. I mean, you got a lot of family. And some are good, some are not so good. Someone we want to claim and someone we wished we did not have the same name. But y'all, it's the same way in the church. We are just people. But somewhere along the line, you're going to say, but this is my family. I didn't choose you. I did not choose who the Lord chose. And someone's like, I just don't know why. I just don't think they're Christian. You better just watch your mouth, because you know what you're talking about? You're talking about the Father's children, and it's his business of who he picks. And you're not the one on the show trying to figure out who's your daddy and your DNA. No, I'm telling you what, it ain't my job to say, to run DNA tests. My job is to love you and treat you as the family of God. And to learn how to settle conflict without running people off or running off myself. You ever had a family member that just completely removed themselves and was missing in action? I had an uncle that way. I had an uncle that left the family when my grandmother got saved. Y'all know I told you the story. They had a nightclub, and they were not a real healthy family, I'll promise you that. Not healthy at all. And my grandmother got saved, but she had three of her kids. They were already grown and was off in the military, off and gone, and one of them was moved off. They were all, but the kids that left at home, 18 and under, which my daddy was a 17-year-old, she made him go to church. And you can look at the family and see the difference. So the ones that was still at home when grandma got saved, you see the influence. All of those kids are still serving God today. Every one of them, and their children are, and they're almost all gone now. My daddy was the youngest. My daddy died first. But his oldest, when grandma got in church, he wasn't around. He missed all that. He'd married some woman. I'm telling you what, and I don't know what all happened, but she had a brawl with my grandma at some point, and she didn't like it. My grandma got saved, and she went and tried to tell them about it, and they're like, we ain't a part of that holy roller bunch of butt stuff. We are not. You are crazy, and you know you're crazy, and we are not. And he had to choose between his family and his wife. And you know what he did? He chose his wife. They disappeared. We did not know whether he was dead or alive. He was gone for 17 years. Nobody had a word, knew a word of him. My grandmother grieved. My grandmother grieved every single year and day over her missing firstborn son because of people having conflict. There's people that are missing in action from church because of conflict. They just remove themselves. How we handle conflict is so huge. First of all, we have to know that it exists, and that does not mean you're bad people. It does not mean that we're a dysfunctional church. Now, there are dysfunctional churches, I'm sure, but I'm telling you, just because you don't get along with somebody does not make it dysfunctional. It just makes us normal. It makes us people that have issues. Is there anybody here that does not have an issue of some sort? And what the beautiful part of some of the things we talked about, even this weekend, the whole the retreats and getting together and these kind of things and some of the fellowship things we try to do, we are trying to bring people into relationship. But I'm going to tell you something. There is an enemy. And the only way Satan knows his tools, he lies, accuses, which is lies again, false accuser, to do what? To divide you, to separate you. He said, because a house divided can't stand. We need each other. Like I started this thing off, this is not anybody. Nobody here can say, I am Jesus. But everybody here can say, I'm a part of the body of Jesus. But Satan wants to deceive you, get your feelings hurt, get you in conflict with somebody, and definitely wants to get you in conflict with your pastors. Why? Because he's trying to cut you off from our gifts and cut you off, us off from your gifts. Handling conflict, and so if we can have a place that's not peaceful, who wants to be a part of that? We have enough junk in our natural lives. When we come in this family, we ought to have peace. Should we not? So I'm not one of those people that just sweeps things under the rug. And I it's really easy for me to preach this right now because I don't know of any conflict going on. So I don't have to look at you. And I ain't looking at you. I really don't. I'm telling y'all, the reason this church is as special as it is because of the love we have and because of the relationships in this room. Does everybody here going to be best friends? No. You take puzzles of pieces. Some of the pieces are all a part of the same puzzles, but some touch, don't they? They're right there together. And so some people you're going to be closer to than others. That's just the way it is. You're going to build bonds. Same way in your family. You build bonds because we are trying to work on a picture. The picture is the glory of God. It's Jesus. We want people to see. He said, they will know you're my disciples. How? By your love. It wasn't because how big your church is. It wasn't because how great you can preach or how great you sing or how great you are and how all perfect. Oh, those people over there, they don't ever do anything wrong. That is not the way he said that they would know you're my people. He said, you're going to know you're my people because you love each other. And you love each other when you don't even like each other sometimes. Do you think Gary and I in 37, 8 years of marriage, whatever it is, have always, we have loved each other, but do you think we've always liked each other? Thank you, Josh. No! Me and him can get as cross. Oh, Lordy. Can y'all imagine him live with me? Y'all need to give this man more prizes. Y'all know how what kind of man it takes to have a woman as strong as I am. And, oh, you know, I could be overbearing, can I? I can be real. I'm passionate, whatever I do. It took that man. Do what? And I have daughters. Oh, yeah. No, but that man, why? Because we learned about order in our home. And I learned how to submit. If I had been an overbearing wife to my husband, there's no way God would have put me in this position. Oh, I might have been one of those people that pushed my way in, which is one of those women the Bible talks about not usurping authority. Usurping means take up on your own accord. It means you're going to come in there and say, no, I'm going to do that. I'm going to do it. That ain't how God works. I can say the one job I have that I never applied for was this one. I never applied for it. Never asked for it. Never made application for it. It's just like something was put in our lap and, okay, we're going to do this for a while. And it's just amazing how God does things. But I can promise you, if I hadn't had 7 years, 7 years, there's a significance in that number, of sitting under ministry of other people where I learned to submit to very strong men. One of them was both of them younger than me. Both of them my brother-in-laws. How do you think that works for you? You want to be trained? You just go sit under an in-law. You'll learn real fast what it's about. This is the training of how to walk in peace. How to walk in peace. Oh, my gosh, this is not even, I ain't even started on this, and it's okay. Let me just read you a couple scriptures here. Proverbs 16 and 7 says, when a man's ways please the Lord. Say, when a man's ways please the Lord. And that's humans. That's men and women, humans. He maketh, read the rest of that. You ever read that one before? That's pretty powerful, isn't it? So where's the responsibility lie? Whether it's in your natural family, your spiritual family, your job, your marriage, your home. When an individual's ways, when my ways, please the Lord, he makes even his enemies be at peace with him. You know what that's saying? It's saying God will fight your battles. When I decide to get myself and start working on myself and quit trying to fix my husband, God started doing a work in him and us that brought us even to here where we could stand up here together today and do what we do. Frank, you can't determine whether people are going to stay at the rehab or they check themselves out. You just have to walk with the Lord yourself. And my ways please the Lord. What kind of ways is it when your kids are doing that it pleases you? How's your son acting when he pleases you? Behaving? Being obedient? Having a good life? Doesn't it please you when your kids are happy? Why do we go to all the trouble for birthday presents and parties and get their little projects ready for school and all the things we do for our children? Because we want to see them happy. We want to see them successful. We don't have to visit them sometimes in the county jail. We don't have to go up there and meet meeting with the teachers and trying to figure out a way to get them through the next class. Or they just realize they're going to get kicked off the game, the team, because they didn't make the grade. And all the things. See, what pleases God is you being all you can be. It's not all about just how pleasing God means you better walk right, talk right. All that stuff. Is that all you're about with your kids? No. Why do you want them to walk right and talk right? Because you want them to have a good life. And you're seeking mom and dad. What is it you know? When we start doing this and you get yourself in order, and no matter what the conflict is about them, Lord, show me what I need to do. And Lord, what are you going to do? Sometimes it's not possible. Let me read. Just come on down to the New Testament. Romans 12 and 18 says, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Now, what's that saying? I can be at peace, and God's going to take care of my enemies. But sometimes it's not possible for me to go and make peace and get that person to like me. They're over. I've already went over the line with them. Only God can work that out. But he says, it's possible that lies in me. Live peaceably with all men. I do my part and let God fight the battle. And there's a way of doing it. And we're not going to get to all that today, but what does that mean, all that's possible, that I can have peace with people? Matthew 5 and 9, my mother's favorite scripture. I think we need to put it on her, add it to her and dad's tombstone. She said, y'all done took up all the space talking about him. I said, ooh, we kind of did because he went first. Mom, we're going to make a room for your scriptures too. Here it is. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. My mother's quoted that to me because I got my daddy's temperament. My mother has that easy going. Me and dad are like Peters out there wanting home. Mama's back there like, okay, be Paul, be a little, you know, be a little wise here, Pam. Calm down. Blessed are the peacemakers. Who's going to call you the children of God? They. Who's they? They'll say, now that's a real Christian. They're not saying you're a real Christian just because you do everything right. Do y'all notice that? They call you a real Christian because you love and you're a peacemaker. That means you're not a trouble causer. Let me just read about them. Ephesians 4 and 30. Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God. What? I can grieve the Holy Spirit of God? Yes. We just heard about pleasing the Spirit. Now he says you can grieve the Spirit. Don't you know? Isn't it pretty cool to think that God has emotions? Do you know the only reason why you have emotions is because he has emotions and he breathed that into you? Emotions is of God. He's a very emotional God. You find all these things about him. I love it when you start seeing how real he is and how much we have in us. But he says, grieve not the Holy Spirit. And he's going to tell you how you grieve him. He said, because you've been sealed with the day of redemption. He goes, God's already took care of you. The Spirit has sealed you. Now, this is what you need to do after you're saved. This is not talking to a bunch of sinners out there don't know God. It's talking to people in this church. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away with you with all malice. The word malice is where we get the word malicious. It just means being a trouble causer. Just being a trouble. And there, here's a picture of them. How they causing trouble. Bitter, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking. Running their mouths about somebody else. Oh, I can't believe they call themselves a Christian. Do you know what they did? Oh, please, you need to pray for Sister So-and-so. Let me tell you what she did. Don't you ever disgrace the word prayer by using it as a way of gossip. I just think you should know. He said, let it be put away with you with all malice and keep going. What's the next one? But this is how you do it. But be kind one to another. Tenderhearted. Forgiving one another. Even as God, for Christ's sake. You ever hear that saying? Well, for Christ's sake. There where it is, right there. For Christ's sake, he forgave you. That's how we might say it. For Christ's sake, God forgave you. Why are you holding on to bitterness? No, but he did it for Christ's sake. He didn't forgive you just because you deserved it. Or you've done something, you're so righteous. No, he's forgiven you for Christ's sake, who died for all that sorriness. He already knew what he was getting when he picked you. That he already sealed you. And he says, now that you're sealed, we got some stuff to do. Because this is how you get to be that body when people out there that's in turmoil and you say, you know, your life's kind of crazy. You're going through all this. Come on to church with me. And they walk in, they feel what they felt today. And they don't just feel it in the spirit, but all of a sudden someone's saying, we're so glad you're here, Chris. We're so glad you're here. We're so glad we're acknowledging you and we're paying attention to you. And that's because there's not anybody that's in here. They don't have to come in and see a bunch of junk that's out there. That's what the enemy wants. The enemy wants you to see everybody's faults and problems. No, but he said, you're going to have faults and you're going to do things to hurt people because you need to forgive each other. So it's a given. I'm going to hurt your feelings sometime. I probably won't even know I did, and I definitely will never intend to. I can promise you it's not my intention, but I will. I will. And you will offend me. You'll hurt my feelings sometime. I may not show it as much, but yeah, I kind of suck it up, but the truth is, I do. But he said, be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another. Is God, for Christ's sake, forgiven you? And talking about tombstones, that's the scripture on my daddy's tombstone. His pastor told him, Brother Jody, you need to read this passage every day. Oh, yeah, that man, I act like he's just Mr. Perfect. No, he wasn't. His pastor said, Brother Jody, you need to read that every day. Forgiving one another as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. This is how you walk in peace. For forgiving each other. Now, I don't know how to go here. I think I'm just going to stop. I'm hoping that you've got enough already. Because I've got to go into this as for Christ's sake, forgiving one another. It's the biggest word in a Christian walk. It's the biggest word in your marriage. It's the biggest word in your family. It's forgiveness. And it's the hardest. In fact, we're going to learn how he's going to twist your arm into it. Because unforgiveness is bitterness. The word unforgiveness is not in the Bible. Look it up. It's not there. The word for forgiveness in the Bible is bitterness. That's what it is. Let all bitterness cease. Because he said if it don't, it'll rise up a root of bitterness. It'll get down there and start in the soil of something of your past. It'll get in you and it'll trouble you, which means it'll take your peace. Take your peace. And he said, not only will it trouble you, but many around you will be defiled. Because the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Heard somebody say, don't ever trust your mouth when you're bitter. I can sit with a couple, I can sit with people, individuals, and they tell me, oh yeah, I forgive them. Like, eh, nope. Your speech betrays you. They may think they have. They're trying to be. I can speak about this because I've been down this road over and over and over. I would learn how to forgive people and how to then be able to follow peace with all men and holiness, which means my life committed to God. Without no man shall see the Lord, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. What does that mean? And what in the world has it got to do with lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you and therefore many be defiled? The grace of God fails you is when you don't look at people through eyes of grace. You're not looking at people the way God sees them. You're looking at them but what they did to you or somebody you love. That's when you fail of the grace. That's not falling from grace. Oh, no, that's what that is. I fail to put grace in this situation. And when I fail to walk in the grace of God, then I can have a root of bitterness spring up and it starts troubling me, takes my peace, and I am a sitting duck for the devil. Because then my shoes are off and I'm barefoot and I'm walking through some thorny things that before I know it, I'm going to be in more pain and hurting people hurt people. Hurting people hurt people. This is a very important message. I hadn't even started on conflict. But this, to follow peace with all men, this is how you do it. And I want to be an expert forgiver. I want to become expert at that. I want to know what it looks like. Because I'm going to talk about this coming up. And I'm going to give you a list of things, what that means to trouble you. And it ain't pretty. I heard a man, a secular psychologist. He wrote a book and they were interviewing him. And he said, there's one thing I can empty 70% of the mental institutions with. One word. Mental institutions. The lady said, what word would that be? He said, forgiveness. This was not a spiritual talk. This was a psychologist talking. And he said, I could empty. In other words, mental illness is tied, in his words, his expert opinion, 70% of the cases where they have become mentally ill is rooted in bitterness, unforgiveness. And I'm going to give you the scriptures that back it up. He calls them tormenting spirits. I think it's one of the most liberating messages that I'm still on a trail about it. I've been studying it and learning about it for some years. And it's been a good while since I've taught on it. But I've seen lives changed. So today, I hope today this is getting you to the point where you realize how important peace is. Because he said this whole armor and the shoes in particular was so that you could stand and not fall down. And that you would withstand, which means you wouldn't get wounded. That the arrows, when he throws them, they're going to bounce off. Because I promise you, he's shooting at your feet. He wants to steal your peace. He wants you to leave the church. He wants to leave your church family. He wants you to get crosswise with somebody that you don't go to the men's meeting, don't go to the women's meeting. Yeah, and crosswise in your home and your family and every which way he can. And the holidays are coming up. And I don't know if you want to be like sister today, so I'm Carla today, and she's been praying for her brother and praying. How many of y'all have family members you pray for? They're looking to you. They will say they're children of God. That means you're going to walk into some places through these holidays, and they, whoever they is, are going to be looking at you, and they need, blessed are the peacemakers. And that's not just peacemakers here. That's peacemakers here. Because what was the first thing? Peace with God. That I'm not in conflict with God. Let's stand up. We have to be prepared. the preparation of the gospel of peace. You need to be prepared to walk out there and understand and know something about conflict yourself and know how to walk in these things. That when a man's ways please the Lord, he makes even his enemies be at peace with you. That's a promise. That was powerful. Father, today, you get a song. Father, today, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this gathering today. You knew who was going to be here. You knew what needed to be said. I thank you that your word is so powerful. It's powerful. It's sharper than a two-edged sword.
There's a peace I've come to know.
There's a peace I've come to know.
Though my heart and flesh,
Lord, let us know this peace. Even when I fall down, even when I mess up, but they'll say there, blessed is the peacemaker.
I can say
it's well.
It is well.
In the middle of a country in conflict, I can still say it's well. In a family that's divided, I can still say it's well. In the middle of marriage strife, I can still say it is well. Because I look to you.